individual here tonight, Lord. Lord, I just ask you to be with each and every person, Lord, and help us to lift you up, God, in our praise and everything that we do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Days of Elijah. Days of Elijah.
Good evening. Let's try that again. Good evening. At least let me think there's more of you here tonight. Amen. It is good to be in God's house tonight. I didn't backslide this morning. I was at another church. But it is nothing like being at home, right? Amen. I have no idea where my help is tonight. I see your two kids come in the door, but I haven't seen her yet. Misty, would you please report to the pulpit? Exactly right. So did y'all have a wonderful service this morning?
Yeah, you weren't
did,
here.
Did Wayne do a good job? I heard that, Paul.
Good.
I was trying to ignore that. Come on, Misty. So, I just turned my phone down, and it's going off again. All right. Let's try this again. Are you glad to be in God's house tonight? Don't be late no more. You'll be fired next time. All right, we'll start. Do you want to see Jesus? Probably more than you want to see me and Misty anyway. Amen. As I journey through this land, singing as I go, pointing souls to Calvary, to the crimson flow. Many arrows pierce my soul from without within, but my Lord leads me on through. I must win. Now come on. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, dancing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Here's a past, holy land, never to rejoice. Winning service for my Lord, dark may be the night, but I'll cling more close to him, he will give me light. Satan's way makes my soul turn my thoughts aside, but my Lord goes ahead, lead what every time. And though I want to see him, look upon his face, let us sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Here's all past, home at last, let's do that course again. Well, oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, let us sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Here's all past, home at last, never to rejoice. When in valleys low, I look toward the mountain height, and behold my Savior there leading in the fight. With a tender hand outstretched toward the valley glow, oh, guiding me, I can see as I lift it up now. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, let us sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Here's all past, home at last, never to rejoice. Just before me billows rise from the mighty deep, then my Lord directs my mark, he does safely lead. And he leads me gently all through this world below. Well, he's a real friend to me, oh, I love him so. And though I want to see him, look upon his face, let us sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Here's all past, home at last, ever to reach. Come on now, oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, let us sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Here's all past, home at last, never to rejoice. Hallelujah. Praise his holy name. Come on up. Come on, put your hands together tonight. righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trial, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Come on now, behold, he comes, riding on a cloud, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. Out in Zion to salvation come. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, filling the temple of praise. Oh, and these are the days of the harvest, cause your fields are white in this world. And we are your laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word. Oh, lift it up now. Behold, he comes, riding on a cloud, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. Oh, come on now, behold, he comes, riding on a cloud, shining like the sun. Oh, I'm coming to lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, out in Zion to salvation come. How many know there's no God like our God tonight? There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes, riding on a cloud, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion will salvation come.
I want to do this no God like Jehovah tonight, but I want you to do it like you mean it.
There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Come on. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no.
Oh, come on. Well,
there's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. Well, behold, he comes riding on a cloud. Well, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. Here of Jubilee, out of Zion till salvation come. Lift your voice, it's here of Jubilee, out of Zion till salvation come.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise his holy name. Know our God's great tonight. Couple people. We serve a great and a mighty God. I want you to think as we begin to sing this song, just think of all the great things God has done for you tonight. Man, I'm sure some of you older than me, some of you younger than me, Misty, he might have done one or two things for her, I don't know. But think about all the great things God has done for you. And as we sing this song tonight, as you sing this song to him, forget about me and Misty standing up here and Paul playing, but concentrate on him tonight and worship him. And when you sing how great you are tonight, God, really mean it. Think about what you're singing.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light. up now. How great is our God.
Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, sing, how great is our God.
God, that sounds so beautiful. Let's just do that chorus one more time. Oh, singing, how great. The beginning and the end. Come on, help me sing. He is the Godhead, three in one. Oh, He is Father, Spirit, and Son. The Lion and the Lamb. The Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Oh, sing with me.
Sing with me, how great is our God.
He puts food on your table. He gives you air to breathe. He gives you the strength to walk. He gives you a voice to talk. If he owns the cattle on a thousand hills, then everything you have in your possession is a gift from God. The money in your wallet or your purse, everything, it's a gift from God. Your children, your loved ones, the ones that he saved, this church as Memorial Day, the freedom to be able to worship in this church and in this country. That's how great a God we got tonight. A God who protects us. A God who loves us. A God who will never let go of us tonight. Can we sing that just one more time? How great is our God.
Sing with me.
Opportunity, as scripture says, to taste and see that the Lord is good. So if you get hungry, he'll feed you. If you get hungry, the Bible says, David said, I've never seen the righteous forsaken nor seed begging bread. So if you get hungry for food, he'll provide. But sometimes you get hungry for a move of God, and he'll provide that as well. Amen.
Lord, I'm hungry for a mighty move of God. Lord, I'm thirsty. Pour out your Holy Ghost. Oh, I want to see the hand of God move mightily inside of me. I'm hungry for a move of God.
Do you want him to touch?
Lord, I'm hungry for a mighty move of God. Lord, I'm thirsty. Pour out your Holy Ghost. Oh, I want to see the hand of God move mightily inside of me. I'm hungry.
If you're hungry tonight, would you just lift your hands and tell him, Lord, I need your touch.
Lord, I'm hungry for a mighty move of God. Lord, I'm thirsty. Pour out your Holy Ghost. Oh, I want to see the hand of God move mightily inside of me. I'm hungry for a move of God.
One more time.
Lord, I'm hungry for a mighty move of God. Lord, I'm thirsty. Pour out your Holy Ghost. Oh, I want to see the hand of God move mightily inside of me. I'm hungry for, oh, I want to see, yes. Oh, I want to see the hand of God move mightily inside of me. I'm hungry for.
Can we do it just one more time? Oh, I want to see.
Yes, I want to see the hand of God move mightily inside of me. I'm hungry for a move of God.
Can you give God a big hand clap?
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Going to share a little bit of scripture again with you tonight, and this is in the book of Jeremiah. This is in chapter 17, and it's verses 5 through 8. It says, "Thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man, and maketh flesh his arm, and whose heart departeth from the Lord. For he shall be like the heath in the desert, and shall not see when good cometh, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, in a salt land, and not inhabited. Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, and whose hope the Lord is. For he shall be as a tree planted by the waters, and that spreadeth out her roots by the river, and shall not see when the heat come. But her leaf shall be green, and shall not be careful in the year of drought, neither shall cease from yielding fruit." I didn't know what a heath was, to be honest with you, other than the fact it rhymes with me, you know, Heath, Keith. I had no other, had no clue. So I wanted to find out just out of curiosity, because, I mean, it felt like it had something that was interesting to it maybe, and sure enough it did. It's a plant, actually, a little shrub that has very shallow roots. So the problem with it being, you know, if it's in a desert-type area or something like that, it can't get deep enough roots to hit the water table or anything like that. So, in other words, it just doesn't flourish whatsoever. So that's what he's likening us to. If we trust in ourselves, if we trust in flesh and we don't trust in God, we're like that little plant. We're not going to make it because we're not rooted into anything. We're not going to get nourishment from God, just like it can't get nourishment from the ground because the root isn't there. But on the other hand, it says, if we do trust in God, what do we like? A tree. Everybody knows that one from the song, "Tree planted by the waters. You know, I shall not be moved." And that spreads out its roots, you know, by the river. You know, again, it's going to get its nourishment. It's going to get fed because it is deeply rooted, and it's right by the river. It's in good ground. So that's the difference. You know, trust yourself in God, everything works out good for you. Trust yourself, you're not going to do so well. You know, trusting in man doesn't get you very far, you know. Amen. It's time for us to take up our tithes and offerings. We'll have the ushers come forward, please. And Isa, I'm going to ask you if you would pray over the offering tonight, please. Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul.
So Nancy's going to sing, so. Amen. We have a children's church tonight? Yes. No teen class. Children's church, you can go on back then, quietly.
Seems like all I could see was the struggle. set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain, 'cause I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain, 'cause I'm not who I used to be. Oh God, I'm not who I used to be. Jesus, I'm not who I used to be. 'Cause I am redeemed.
Amen. Isn't it good to be in God's house? Amen. 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 I'm excited about what God is doing, because God seems to be really shaking some things up, stirring some things up. And how many of you all know every once in a while we need a little shaking, we need a little stirring? Because what happens when you just leave water sit? After a while it gets stagnant. And I'm reminded that Paul wrote twice to Timothy, stir up the gifts that is in you. So we need to let God sort of do a little stirring every once in a while. Let's all stand for the reading of the word. Jonah chapter 4. What do you mean by this? She's got it? Okay. I want to make sure she's got it. Jonah chapter 4, start reading at verse 5. Okay? You got that up there? Oh my goodness. All right. Yeah, she tried to tell me. I know, it's impossible. All right, I've got it here, so I'll read it here. Then Jonah went out to the east side of the city and made a shelter to sit under as he waited to see what would happen to the city. And the Lord God arranged for a leafy plant to grow there, and soon it spread its broad leaves over Jonah's head, shading him from the sun. This eased his discomfort, and Jonah was very grateful for the plant. But God also arranged for a worm. The next morning at dawn, the worm ate through the stem of the plant so that it withered away. And as the sun grew hot, God arranged for a scorching east wind to blow on Jonah. The sun beat down on his head until he grew faint and wished to die. Death is certainly better than living like this, he exclaimed. Then God said to Jonah, is it right for you to be angry because the plant died? Yes, Jonah retorted, even angry enough to die. Then the Lord said, you feel sorry about the plant, though you did nothing to put it there. It came quickly and died quickly. But Nineveh has more than 120,000 people living in spiritual darkness, not to mention all the animals. Should I feel sorry for such a great city? Can we go before the Lord in prayer tonight? Dear Lord, we come to you tonight and we thank you, God, for your presence which we felt here tonight. And we ask your anointing, dear God, upon your word. We ask you, Lord, to anoint our ears to hear what the Spirit would say to us. Anoint our eyes, Lord, to look into spiritual realms. Anoint our hearts, Lord, to be open and receptive to your word. And Lord, anoint my mouth to proclaim your word with boldness and power. And we thank you, God, for what you've done, what you're doing, and what you're going to do. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. We all know this story, right? We've heard this story from the time we were, you know, knee-high to a grasshopper. You know, Jonah and the whale. How that God told Jonah to go preach to the city of Nineveh. And Jonah, instead of going to preach to the city, decided he wasn't going to do it, so he tried to run away. And he got on a boat, and the boat went out in the sea, and a great storm came, and they found out that it was Jonah's fault that the storm was there. And so they threw Jonah overboard, and God arranged for a great fish or a whale to swallow Jonah. He was in the belly of that great fish for 3 days, 3 nights, until finally the fish vomited him up on the shore. And he went into the city, preached in the city. The city had a great revival. They repented and God saved the city. We've all heard that story many, many times. But you know, the thing is what Jonah did afterwards, after that. This little section at the end of the book of Jonah is something that we sometimes overlook. And you know, if we think about Jonah, we don't hear the story of Jonah and the revival. We hear the story of Jonah and the whale. So the whole book of Jonah, there are only 10 verses out of 38 or 48 in this whole book that's dedicated to a revival. The rest of it is dedicated to a man building up walls and running from God, and a man that's trying to get out of doing what God wanted him to do. Now, none of us have ever done that, have we? That God has asked us to do something, and we go out and we do it immediately, right? It got quiet, didn't it? You know, tradition tells us that Jonah was the lad that was brought back to life by the prophet Elijah. So here was a man who had seen a great many things. You know, he had seen Elijah. He had been there with the prophet Elijah. He had no doubt seen the miracles that Elijah had taken place there. And you would think that somebody who had seen this, somebody who had been raised from the dead, when God would speak to them, that they would have it, they would run out and do what God told them to do, right? You would think that. Yet here we find out a man that does almost exactly the same thing that most all of us do when God asks us to do something. God, I don't want to do it. God, I'm not going to do it. And as a result of it, I'm going to go in the opposite direction, God, that you would have me to go. And because of that, what happens? We end up getting in trouble, don't we? We end up basically going and falling into the belly of a great whale until finally, like Jonah did in that belly, repented of what he had done. And then God had mercy on him and spit him and had the great fish spit him out up on the shore. So here's this man that through most of this book is doing nothing but being disobedient to God through most of the book, except for 10 verses within the book. And then he gets upset about those 10 verses in the book because his message to the city was repent or God's going to destroy this city. And the city did exactly what he preached. The city repented and God saved the city. But did that satisfy Jonah? No. He wanted God to go ahead and destroy the city anyway. You know, God, you know, I could just hear him now because I think that we all have a tendency to think like Jonah sometimes. God, you had me go in and preach this message. God, you had me do this thing. And now, God, you because you're loving and because you're kind and because, God, you accept people's repentance, God, you're not going to do it. God, you let me down. Don't we all do that? God, you let me down. God, you know, God, I had it all figured out. I had you all figured out, God. And now, God, you have let me down. So, God, I'm going to go run off and I'm going to pout a while. And that's where we find Jonah here. Jonah has gone off to the city, outside the city, to where he can overlook the city. And he can see God bring down his vengeance upon this city. God, I want you to rain down fire and brimstone upon this. You said you were going to destroy it, so I'm going to sit here, God, until you destroy this city. What did he do? He pouted, just like many of us do, don't we? God, you said you were going to do this for me, and God, you let me down, so I'm just going to go sit off over here and pout a while. God, you said that you were always going to take care of me, and now this horrible, God, now I got a hangnail. How am I ever going to survive, God? You let me down. And so Jonah went off over here to wait for the city to be destroyed. And God, out of his compassion, put a plant there for Jonah. And that plant was to ease the sun off Jonah's head. And this is where I know God has a sense of humor. Because then God made a worm. And the worm came and cut the plant. And the plant withered and died. And the sun beat down on poor old Jonah's head. And then not just that, but God made a wind to come and blow the heat on Jonah. And Jonah was like, oh, God, just take me on. God, I've had enough. This it's too hot, God. I can't take it anymore. And God brought up something here to Jonah that I think a lot of us overlook. God said to Jonah, he said, listen, you have more compassion on for a plant that you did not plant than you have for this city. And many of us today, we have more compassion over the little things than we do those that are out there in the world dying and that are on their way to hell. We have more compassion over the temperature of the sanctuary. And we get more upset over the temperature in the sanctuary than we do that there are those out there that are on their way to hell. And we get down on our knees and we pray, God, won't you send somebody? God, won't you send somebody? Won't you, God, help these people that are out there that are lost and dying? God, won't you send somebody to go that will preach to them, that will minister to them? God, why don't you go and do something? God, why don't you do something? And God looks right at us and he says, I did. I made you. You see, folks, we are the ones that's supposed to take it out of the sanctuary. We are the ones that's supposed to be like Jonah. Jonah here was going into a city that was very vile, a city that was so corrupt that God was going to bring down judgment upon that city and destroy it. And Jonah went and he preached a very simple message. And the message was, God's going to destroy this city unless you all repent. A very simple message. And as a result of that message, a great revival took place. What would happen with us? What would happen in the church? What would happen in the community today if we went out and we spoke to those that are out there that are lost and dying and said, God loves you and God has something better for you than what you're going through right now. And God wants you to be part of his kingdom. What would happen if we were to take it out of these four walls that are in here and preach it out there in the streets? What type of change would take place within the community? You would see people that are heroin addicts coming in. Why? Because sin cannot stand where the presence of God is. This is the only problem. Most of the time, we think the presence of God is right in here. And we keep him right in here. And the devil says, as long as you keep God in here, I'm all happy with that. We've got our walls built up right here. I wasn't planning on going this way, but I'm going with it. We got our walls built up right here. We've got God walled in into a church building. And as a result of that, the enemy is running rampant out there. You see, what happens whenever you build a wall around a city, you build that wall to protect you from what's going on out there. And many of us, we have built those walls to protect us from those sinners that are out there, those people that are dirty out there, those people that maybe smell a little funny out there. We built up those walls around us, and we are just as pious as Jonah as a result of that, because we think, God, you see what they're doing. God, destroy them. And we sit back and we wait for God to bring down his judgment. But you know what? I read in my Bible that God wants those people saved just as much as he wanted you saved. And if we don't go out and bring them in, who is going to do it? Who is going to do it? If we come to God on judgment day and God points to us and they say, why didn't you go out and preach to them? Why didn't you go out and tell them that I love them? Why didn't you go out and spread the news to them? Well, God, they had a funny smell to them. God, they're an addict and I didn't want to have anything to do with them. God, those weren't your people, God. I want it just to be with your people, God. I want to be where it's comfortable, God. We are just then as pious as Jonah was, because what we are doing is we are condemning a world that Jesus died for. Let me tell you what, folks. He didn't just die for those that are in here. He died for those out there also. He died for those that are out there that are lost and that are dying and that are on their way to a devil's hell. And if we don't do something about it, come judgment day, God's going to bring down his wrath on us. Why? Because we did nothing. Let me tell you what, folks, it is just as bad to sit around and do nothing as it is to sit around and point fingers and condemn people. Why? Because silence is not golden. Silence is not golden when it comes to spreading the word of God. And that's what we are called to do. Let me tell you, it's easy, Steve, to be a witness in here. It's easy to get up and preach in here. It's easy to get up and sing in here. But you take it outside these four walls. You go into a Kroger out there and you pass by somebody and the Spirit moves on you and says, that person needs to hear that I love them. You try it there. You try it on your workplace when you see someone comes in and they're down and they're depressed because of some burden that they're carrying, and yet we do nothing about it. You see, it's easy while we're in here, while we're within these four walls. But what we need to do, church, is to realize that we have to take it outside of these walls. We've got to knock that back wall out and take it right on out of here. Because if we don't take it out of here, we're condemning them. By our inaction, we are condemning them. Amen. By our sitting back and doing nothing, we are condemning them. And we sit back just like Jonah under a little vine and say, okay, God, when's it going to happen? You see, we sit back and we be so pious sometimes because we think, Norman, God, I can't wait for you to come back. God, oh, come back. Let the rapture take place now. How can we say that when we have family members that are lost? How can we say that when there are friends that are lost? How can we say, even so, Lord Jesus, come quickly, when there are those out there that God has called us to go out and to talk to? How can we say that? How can we say, God, I want you to come right now? And it's condemning those to a devil's hell by doing that. You see, God has called each and every one of us to tear down the walls that we have built up around us to be all nice and safe and Christian, and to actually go out and get dirty, to actually go out into the highways and the byways and the hedges and to compel them to come in. God has called us to do that. I was at a church down in Cynthiana, Kentucky. I was a music pastor down there, and they wanted to start a bus program down there. How many of y'all know a bus program is great? Everybody loves bus. Oh man, come on. We're going to get a bus. We're going to bus them in. And the pastor got up on a Sunday morning. He says, I want you to understand before we do this what's going to happen. The walls are going to get dirty. There are going to be children and people coming in here that are going to say things that might shock you. There are people that are going to come in that's not going to maybe smell the best. There are people that are going to come in carrying a lot of problems, a lot of burdens, a lot of stuff on their back. He said, but I want you to understand that those are the ones that we need to be reaching. Those are the ones that we need to be going out and getting. Because it's not how pretty it is in here. Let me tell you, Steve, there are a lot of churches around the world today that are beautiful. There are a lot of churches today that you walk into. Oh my, I was out in Colorado Springs a couple of years back. Walked into the Air Force Academy sanctuary there. Seats 1,200 people. Has the most beautiful marble floors, this beautiful roof in there. It's just immaculate. And yet I stood there and wondered, when was the last time someone actually gave their heart to their Lord, to the Lord in that place? You see, you can walk into some beautiful churches, even in this area, with beautiful marble statues and beautiful stained glass windows, and it's just immaculate. And yet you sit back and you think, when was the last time they actually reached out to somebody? When was the last time somebody actually got saved? When was the last time someone that sits in that particular sanctuary felt the calling upon them to go out and to minister to somebody? When was the last time that somebody sat in there, actually heard the Jonah call to go out and to preach before God brings his judgment down upon people? When was the last time that happened? You see, folks, God has called each and every one of us and given us the Jonah message to go out and to tell others, you need to get right before it's too late. You need to know that God loves you. You need to know that there is a God out there. Doesn't matter what the world says. Doesn't matter what the government says. There is a God out there. And that God loves you. And that God died for you. And he rose from the grave for you. And he's there. All you got to do is call on his name. You see, we've all been given that. That Jonah message. We've all been given that. And yes, we sit back and we do nothing about it. And we sit back and we say, God, why don't I feel your presence? God, why don't you move in my life like you move in the life of brother so-and-so or move in the life of sister so-and-so? And God says, because I have called you so many times. And yet you built up a wall between me and you because you won't do what I've asked you to do. I've called you so many times to go out and to witness to those that are right around you, and yet you do nothing. Why should I bless somebody who's disobedient to me? Why should I bless somebody that's not heeding the call for these last days to go outside of the four walls in here and to preach the message to a world that's lost and dying out there? You know, God has given each of us a great opportunity. There's a very wealthy man, Richard Branson. I don't know how many of you all know who Richard Branson is. He's an extremely wealthy man. He made a statement. He says, if somebody offers you an amazing opportunity, you should not think about it, but you should say, yes, I will do it. Even if you're not sure about it, and then you learn how to do it later. You see, God has given each one of us an incredible opportunity. And the opportunity is this, to go out and to spread his word to those that are lost and dying. To go out and to tell others that God loves you. To go out and tell others that there is a loving God. To go out and to do that. Well, I don't know how to do it. Well, you learn how to do it. If you say, well, I don't know how to witness to somebody, Norman, Steve, Keith, myself, Jim, any of us could probably sit down and show you in a few minutes how to witness to somebody. The ABCs of salvation. The Roman road of salvation. But I don't know how to do it. Learn how to do it. You know, I taught junior achievement this year. And the one thing I stressed to those kids in junior achievement was this. Never stop learning. Never stop learning. And yet many of us as Christians, when we get saved, we think, I've arrived. And I'm not going to do anything else. I've got my seat. Don't nobody else sit in it. It's my seat. I've arrived. And I'm not doing one other thing. That's the way many people feel. But let me tell you what. God didn't save us just so we could sit and do nothing. God didn't equip us just so that we could sit and do nothing. God did not empower us so we could sit on that and do nothing. God equipped us. God empowered us so we could take it outside of these walls into the world out there. God gave us the Holy Spirit so that we could actually open our mouths and talk and proclaim the word of God. Do you remember how Peter was before the day of Pentecost? Yeah, he was a loud mouth, all right. He was the one that Jesus was always saying, don't you get it? You know, that was Peter. Peter was the one that denied Christ. Yet after the day of Pentecost, after he received the power of the Holy Spirit, he became a totally different person who was not afraid to stand up and tell others about Christ. He was not afraid to go out and tell others about Christ. I think many times that there are people that want the Holy Spirit, yet they're afraid to get the Holy Spirit because of what he might ask them to actually do. God, I want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, but you might ask me to be a missionary to Uganda. God, I want the Holy Spirit, but you might ask me to actually witness to my neighbor. You see, the Holy Spirit isn't given to us just so we could feel good in here. It's given to us to empower us to take it out there. That's what it's for. That's what he is for within us. Because what was the first thing they did when they received the power of the Holy Spirit? They went out. They didn't stay in that upper room, did they? They went out of that upper room. They went out of there and they started witnessing to the people. They went out there and Peter preached a great message that day. I would have loved to have been there to hear that message. And thousands got saved. What would happen if one of us, if a handful of us, grasped that concept fully? That I have been empowered not to feel goosebumps on Sunday morning, but I've been empowered so others can feel the presence of God when I'm out there in the world. So that when I walk up to people, they look at me and they say, there's something different about you. You have a joy about you. So that when I walk up to people and I see that they are burdened, that you can give me the spiritual eyes to know how to talk to them. You see, folks, there is a world out there that's dying, that's lost, and yet we sit in here in our little air-conditioned sanctuary and think this is what it's all about. We sit in here and we wait for me or Steve or Misty or anybody to get up here and maybe sing the song that'll make you feel something. We sit in here and we think, well, maybe Steve, maybe Wayne's going to preach the sermon that's going to move me today. And if Wayne's not there, I am sure not going to listen to Steve preach. We are not called to sit in here. We are not called to raise our hands only in here. We are not called to only praise God in here. We are not called to just pray here. We are not called just to open the word or to read the scripture up here in here. We are called to take it out of this place, to go out of here. And like I said, yeah, but many times we sit back and we say, but God, I am not being blessed by you. God, I don't know what's going on. But God, I don't feel anything. I'm reminded of one of the judges, Barak. I guess that's how you pronounce his name. He was a judge, and he was called to go battle Sisera. Right. And Barak, he said, yeah, I'll go do it. Only if the prophetess Deborah will go with me. I'll go do it, but I'm not going to do it by myself. She better go with me to help me out. And Deborah said to him, okay, I'll go with you, but you'll get none of the glory. Right. A woman will get the glory. And sure enough, there was a woman that killed Sisera, put a tent peg through his head. Yeah. You see, folks, we sit back and we say, God, why aren't you blessing me? Because God is saying, I've called you to do something and you're not doing it. I've called you to go out and to witness. I've called you to tear down the walls around you, and yet you're not doing it. Why should I bless you? Isaiah 6:8 says, then I heard the Lord asking, whom shall I send as a messenger to this people? Who will go for us? And Isaiah said, here am I, Lord, send me. You see, that call is still going out today. That God is saying, who is going to go for me? Who's going to take it out there? Yeah, we have Jesus Fest. That's good enough, isn't it? No. Yeah, we have community outreaches. That's good enough, isn't it? No. What about the people that are right around where you live? What about the people that are right where you work? What about your family? What about your friends? You see, what about them? Because they still need to hear the message. And you might be the only Jesus they ever see. You might be the only one that can convince them. You see, I was out in Phoenix, Arizona, many years ago, Phoenix First Assembly, Tommy Barnett's church, and they were displaying the ministries that they have there within the church. At that time, they had 164 different ministries within the church. I think it's over 200 now, ministries within the church. And one of the ministries is a motorcycle ministry. And I'm sitting up in the choir area because they found out I could sing, so they stuck me up in the choir. And I'm sitting up there, and all of a sudden I hear rumbles of motorcycles. And these motorcycles come out on this stage, and here's these guys and gals dressed in leather, you know, with tattoos all over them and long hair and all of that. And I thought, oh my, we're being invaded. And it was one of the ministries there called Church on the Wind. And Tommy Barnett, he was dressed in his suit and tie and all that stuff. And the one guy that was like the head of that church, like he was the pastor of the Church on the Wind, said this: if a man like Tommy Barnett dressed in a tie was to try and go talk to some of the people in my group, they would laugh at him because he doesn't understand where they've been. He doesn't understand them. Why? Because he's in a suit and he's in a tie and he doesn't understand. Yet I can reach him because I've been there. You see, there are those around you that you can reach because you've been there. Because you know what it's like. You know what they're going through. You know what it is, and you know what God has done in your life. Amen. And they can hear from you the message that they need to hear. A message that Wayne can't deliver to them, or Steve, or myself, or Norman can't deliver. Why? Because you're there and we're not. You see, by the time you would say, you know, Norman, I need you to come over and witness to this person, the opportunity is lost. It's up to you. You know, I'm reminded of a story in the Bible where Jesus is talking. And Jesus says, I think this is in Matthew 21. Jesus says, but what do you think about this? I love the common English that they put in into the scripture. What do you think about this? A man with two sons told the older boy, son, go out and work in the vineyard today. And the son answered, no, I won't go. But later changed his mind and went anyway. Then the father told the other son, you go. And he said, yes, sir, I will. But he didn't go. Which of the two obeyed his father? And they replied, the first. Then Jesus explained his meaning. I tell you the truth, corrupt taxpayers and prostitutes will get into the kingdom of God before you do. Why? Because even though you might have said no, you later repented and said, yes, I will go. Yes, I will do it. You see, one was a liar. Yes, I'll go, and then he didn't. But the other was a man of repentance. I won't go, but I changed my mind, so yes, I will go. Right. You see, which one are we? When God calls us to go do something, are we going to go do it? Or are we going to give God lip service? A lot of the times, it's lip service. God, yes, I'll go. God, oh God, yes, I'll go. Oh, I forgot. You see, folks, we've been talking about building walls. And we've been talking about the walls within our lives. But we have walls right here. And those walls are walls that we come into 3 times a week and feel safe. And we come into 3 times a week and we get recharged. And we come into here and we go out, but we leave it here. We leave it here when we need to be taking it with us out there. You see, God has called us to go out of these 4 walls. Church is not a building. Church is people. Church is you and me, which means that we can have church wherever we go. If it's at the gas station, if it's at Kroger, if it's at home, if it's in our backyard, we could have it anywhere, which means the opportunity to witness to somebody is everywhere we go. Everywhere we go. You see, what are we going to do? I made a couple of notes down here in closing. God prepared for Jonah, and he's prepared for all of us, a purpose. We all have a purpose. Our purpose is to go out and to spread the gospel. Our purpose is to go out and to witness to those that are around us. That is our purpose. He prepared for Jonah a message. He's prepared for us a message. Did you know God loves you? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let me tell you what he has done for me. He gave to him a mission, and our mission is to go out there, not to stay in here. Because of his disobedience, God then had to go out and prepare a storm. He had to prepare a fish. He had to prepare a shade. He had to prepare a worm. He had to prepare an east wind. And the book of Jonah ends so suddenly. Because here's God speaking, and God says, listen, you have more compassion over that plant than you do over those people. Right. And it's sort of like, boom, that's it. And you know what? We don't know if Jonah was ever blessed as a result of it. We don't know. All we know is Jonah and the whale, not Jonah and the great revival. You know, what are we doing? Are we just sitting back and taking it all in and not taking it out there? Are we sitting back and just being sponges, taking it all in? Are we sitting back like Jonah, saying, God, come quickly, and yet there are those that are lost and dying out there? Are we sitting back in our little pious seat thinking, I'm better than they are? I don't want to get my hands dirty. You know, I'm going to wind it up with two little stories here. One story, and I know you've all heard it, is about Pastor Simbala up there at Brooklyn Tab. How there was a man that was outside of the church that was basically laid in his own vomit and urine. And the pastor would walk by him and just, you know, just like, oh, gross. And that's the way many of us look on sinners. Gross. How can they stand to live that way? Why don't they get up and do something with their lives? Well, when was the last time you talked to them? When was the last time you got down and talked to them? And that man one time came in. They were having a really good service. And the man one time walked in, walked down to the front. And the pastor was like, oh, no, he's going to come in here and beg for money. He's going to come in here and he's going to mess everything up because he stinks. And he came down to the front and he searched out the pastor. And the pastor stood there and the man stood there, and just the reek of the vomit and the urine coming off the man was just so strong and so pungent. And the man looked at the pastor and he says, you know, he said, I've been sitting out there listening to what's going on in here. And I want what you guys have. And the pastor standing there realized how pious he had been toward this man. How he had built a wall up between that man and him. And he said he grabbed the man and hugged him. And that stench that was so pungent turned into a beautiful fragrance. And the man gave his heart to the Lord that day. You see, folks, there are those that are out there that we think, I am not going to dirty my hands with them. And you might be the only one that can reach them. Reminded of a story of a lady that was dreaming one night. And in her dream, she saw hell. And she looked down and she saw coming from the pits of hell a demon carrying a letter in its hand. And the demon appeared at the foot of the bed of this woman and handed the letter to her. And the woman opened up the letter, and it was from her friend. And the letter started out, I thought you were my friend. We did things together. Our families were close. We would share meals together. And yet not once did you tell me about Jesus. You know, I was there for you when you were sick. And when my family was sick, you would come over and help us, yet not once did you offer to pray with us. I once called you my friend, but you're no friend of mine. And with that, the woman woke up and shot up out of the bed and said, I promise you, God, I will call her first thing in the morning. Got up the next morning, called. The woman's husband answered the phone, and she said, I want to speak to your wife. He said, didn't you know she died last night in a car accident? You see, folks, who are we calling friend, and yet we're treating them like our enemy? We're treating them like nobody. We're treating them like trash because we haven't taken the time to tear down the walls and to witness to them. And to talk to them. You see, if somebody is your friend, you love them enough to care about them. not just care about this, but to care about their soul also. You see, God has called each and every one of us for a purpose. We've all been given the Jonah call in our lives to go out and to tell others about Jesus, who is truly fulfilling that call tonight. Can we stand? You see, you can have the best intention in the world, but good intentions are for naught if you don't follow through with them. You can have the best knowledge of the Bible in the world, but if you sit back and hold it all in, it's useless. You can be fully empowered with the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, and yet, if you don't open your mouth outside of these four walls, it's a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. It's nothing. You see, folks, what are we doing? What are we doing when we come here? Are we just coming here just so we can appease our conscience? Just so that we can feel good about ourselves? Are we coming here just so we can walk out the door and go up to, I went to church today, and laud it over people? Or are we coming here so that we can get fired up and we can get a message and we can get the Spirit within us so we can take it out of here and give it to those that are in need out there? You see, folks, what are we doing? Are we coming in and playing church? Church can be out there too. It's not just here. With every head bowed and every eye closed, I'm going to ask you tonight, do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? If you don't know Him, you need to come to know Him. You need to know Him. Why? Because time is short. His coming is nigh. And it's His will that nobody be lost. He's extending it so that perhaps your neighbor can hear you tell them about Jesus. You see, folks, if you do not know Him as your Lord and Savior, you need to know Him. Time is of the essence. I'm going to open the altars for you tonight. Just come down. We'll pray with you. We won't embarrass you. If you're here tonight and you say, Brother Paul, what you've said has stomped on my foot really hard, these altars are for you. Because, folks, we need to tear down the walls thinking that just because I come to church, I've got it. No, you don't. It's through our witness that's what really makes us strong. It's through our witness that we really convince ourselves how great God is. Why? Because we're telling others about Him. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say a little prayer. And then I'm going to open up the altars. And I'm going to ask you to come down tonight. We're not going to have, I'm not going to play and sing. We're just going to have Jessica play and a little music in the background in the back. And I'm going to ask you to come down tonight and pray. And pray, God, use me. God, open doors for me. God, I've held it back too long. I've kept my mouth shut too long. God, use me. Dear Lord, we come to You tonight and we thank You for this time, dear God. And we ask You, Lord, in Jesus' name, that You use us, God. And that, God, You give us the courage to be used by You. The words to say, Lord. Lord, the song to sing. Lord, the pat on the back that someone might need out there. God, help us to tear down the walls of prejudice between us and those that are out there needing You, God. I ask You, God, just to help us tonight. We thank You, Lord. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, can we gather around tonight and spend some time in prayer? Come on, let's gather around.
Didn't Paul do a wonderful job tonight of bringing the word? Amen. If the first few services that we've been having so far on this series of tearing down the walls, if that's indicative of where we're going with that, I think this is a tremendous opportunity for a lot of people to experience some real growth in the next 6 weeks or however long this is going. You know, I really do. I think there's an opportunity for that. You can definitely sense that God's trying and wanting to do things. Now the question is, are we going to allow him to do what he wants to do? You know, the ball's in our court now. I don't think there's any question what his desire is. The question is, are we going to go along with it? Are we going to allow it to happen? That's a choice for all of us to understand that we have to make, right? Amen. Hopefully we'll make the right choices on that. Amen. Anybody had any testimony or anything that they want to do? Kevin?
I just want to thank God right now for what he has brought me through. You see, this coming Friday, I'll be graduating from high school, and I just thank God he's allowed me to do something like this. And I'm very thankful for my parents and everyone in my family for supporting me during this time of that's about to happen. Lord, I just, without him, there's nothing that I can do. Whenever I get bored, and I always turn to the Bible for help, and I turn to God for his guidance. Lord, I just want to thank him for everything he's brought me and my family through.
Amen. That's a wonderful testimony, actually. When you just sit there and say that I can't do anything without God, which is when you break it down, that's what he just said. He said, I can't do anything without God. Steve sings a song about that. Can't walk without Jesus. Can't talk without him. Can't do anything without the Lord. Well, that's the same thing here. That's what Kevin just said, basically. I can't do anything without God, and he recognizes that. Amen. All minds clear? Okay. I'd like to go ahead and pray us out. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this service. We thank you for this opportunity to have been here and heard your word. We thank you for your presence and that of the Holy Spirit in our services today. We ask you to watch over us, Heavenly Father, as we each go to our home. Keep your loving arms wrapped around.